Okay. So it's a pleasure to be here. And this talk differs from talks I usually give in a number of ways. One, it's not entirely about my work. As a matter of fact, it's about half about things I wasn't involved in at all. And it's a kind of survey of computational imaging, computational photography. So this is a story which is not new to any of you, I think. This is what we used to take pictures with, and now, of course, photography has evolved. Instead of just being having photons land on a silver halide sensor, we have optics we can modify, we have sensing we can modify, we have post-sensing computation that we can modify as well. And this dramatically expands the design space for photography, and in the academic field and in industry as well. Right now, it's a very exciting time of exploring this new design space of how can we modify both the optics and the computation, or both the sensing and the computation, to achieve things that we couldn't before. So here's a camera, and here's an exploded view of a camera. And what I want to do is go through sort of piece by piece of a camera, different pieces of it that we can modify in conjunction with modifying the computation and push out new pieces of the design space. So I got to emphasize here, since I know many of you in the audience work in the area of computational photography, this list of my favorite things here is not a comprehensive list of my favorite things. It's just what we're talking about in the talk, and it's not a comprehensive list of the exciting things. And I'll look forward to connecting with you in the rest of the morning about other parts of this new design space. So it's hard to really pinpoint the first really piece of computational photography. It's been going on really for many years in Kodak, Polaroid, and other photographic companies. But in my mind, the real sort of signature piece of computational photography work was the wavefront coding work done by researchers at the University of Colorado. And it was this great counterintuitive idea, Dvorsky and Kathy, the authors. Let's take a lens and put an element in front of it which will make everything blurred. How's that going to be good? Well, it makes everything blurred in a very special way. Namely, everything is blurred independently of what depth the object is at relative to the lens. So ordinarily with a camera, if you have a wide aperture lens, you'll have some narrow ranges in focus, and things in front or behind it are out of focus. So with wavefront coding, the idea is let's put this cubic phase plate in front of the lens, make everything out of focus, but in a particular way. Namely, everything is out of focus with an identical point spread function. And now we can go post-process this computationally and de-blur, remove the blur from that phase plate that we've introduced, and come up with an image where everything is in focus. So that's here's the original image, and then here's, after post-processing, something where everything is focused no matter what the depth is. And this is just a sort of quintessential piece of computational photography. Okay, now moving back, let's modify the aperture. Let's put a code in the aperture. So let's talk a little bit about why that would be useful. So this is work that I was involved with. And with my collaborator, Fredo Durand at MIT, and also Ramesh Raskar's group independently did a very similar thing. Okay, so here's a side view. Here's the focal planes for this lens. Here's an object that's out of focus. And at the sensor plane, it makes a point spread function that looks roughly like this in cross-section. What we're going to do is put a coded aperture, a set of occluding and non-occluding pieces in the aperture, and we'll make a funky little point spread function as shown there. So now, here's a different view. Here's the lens, and here's the point spread function from that lens. Now when we move things at different positions relative to the focal plane, the point spread function changes size, you can see there. And so what have we gained? It'll turn out that we've gained the ability to do several things. One, to estimate much better what the depth distance is of the object that we're imaging, in addition, it makes it somewhat easier to de-blur the effects of that out-of-focus blur. So let's see a little bit how that works. With a conventional aperture, there are two problems that you have to overcome. One is, even if someone tells you what the depth of the object is that's blurred from defocus, from not being in the focal plane, it's still hard to de-blur it because the point spread function of this of the aperture is, has a lot of zeros that are difficult to, you lose a lot of information. But even on top of that, it's, if someone doesn't tell you what the depth is, it's difficult to infer what the correct depth is. So let's say here's the image that you're trying to explain. It's a blurry image. And here are some candidate point spread functions caused by, these are images of your aperture caused by the object being at different depths. So here it's way out of focus, then less and less. So with this degree of being out of focus, it's actually quite difficult to come up with a, an image which convolved with this point spread function gives you the observed blurred image. But here is one, and we have a, an image that when blurred with this point spread function gives you the data you saw. And here's a different image when blurred with this other depth blur function gives you this image that you saw as well. And you can't really distinguish between these two, and therefore it's difficult between to distinguish, to estimate what depth the object is at given this data. It's both blur kernels equally well explain the image that you see. So we want to address both those issues with a coded aperture, and let's see how that does. This slide doesn't explain it, but it turns out that this crazy little impulse response is a little bit easier to deconvolve than this one, which has a lot of, loses a lot of information. But what is shown on this slide is that this very unique blur kernel that we're introducing makes it much easier to determine what the size of this is if you are in imaging conditions where you don't know what the size of the blur kernel is. And so, for the image data, which is not shown in the slide, it's very hard to construct an image which, when blurred by this kernel, explains the data. Hard to construct one when blurred by this one. But here, there's only one depth layer where the image can be well explained by blurring something with this coded aperture at that depth. And another important piece that I think of when I think of computational photography is it really also forces you to think hard about what is an image and come up with mathematical prior probabilities that characterize images. For this particular problem, we had to use it in three different places. We had to use priors on images when we estimated the depth from the defocused image data, when we deconvolved, and also when we tried to design the optimal aperture code. So just to show a piece of that, here we're trying to estimate the unknown depth for a given piece of given patch of local blurred image data, and there are two terms that come in. One is, can we come up with a latent image patch, which when you convolved with one of the unknown blur kernels, gives you the data that you saw? And then the second is, whatever we came up with to be blurred by that kernel, it better look like an image. And so we have a prior that penalizes strong gradients as a sort of rough and ready proxy for what we can describe mathematically as an image. So these visually are these two terms that the blur kernel you decide on when convolved with the latent image has to look like what you saw in the camera, and then plus the derivatives of that thing should be minimal. Then there's one more prior that we have to fold into this to really make it work well. If you use this method to try to estimate the depth at every point, here's what you get. This is a color-coded picture of the depth estimate for this scene. Blue is far away and red is close up. You can see it has a rough idea, but it's really pretty noisy. And so we put in yet another prior. We say, well, we think the depths are rather smooth, and we think occasionally they break where there's a strong image gradient, but otherwise they're very close to each other. And this is a yet another prior, this time on the depth arrangements. And we enforce this with a Markov random field and come up with this final regularized, if you will, estimate for what the depths were from this. So in summary, then tying it together, what we get from this coded aperture image is a single image, which lets us estimate the depth everywhere and lets us overcome depth of field effects so that we can make things that were blurred in the original image, make them sharp. And then the final thing I should mention also, you have a lot of choice as to what kind of code you put in the aperture. And so we used a Gaussian prior on images to help us quickly go through the design space of candidate codes. And we had a number of restrictions of what they were. We're just going to use a binary pattern, so it was easier to design. We had a certain minimum hole size to minimize the effects of diffraction. We didn't allow any hanging chads, no floating parts, and certain aperture restrictions. And that led us to this optimal design for an aperture, for a code. So how well does it work? So first, as a controlled experiment, let's take a shallow depth of field image with a conventional aperture and try the same techniques that we use later to deblur it, but with the coded aperture. Here, using a non-coded aperture, we're finding it, we don't accurately estimate what the depths of some of these regions are. Then when we try to deconvolve, we get artifact regions from using the incorrect estimate of the depth to try to estimate what the unknown image was. Instead, if we use the coded aperture and use the same mathematical techniques following, we're able to get a much better estimate of the depth everywhere and able to get much better image reconstructions. So out of the single image, we get both image and depth. So what can you do with that? Well, you can go take a picture, and then after you've taken it, you can say, well, I really didn't want to focus on what I was focusing on there. I want to change the focus. But now you can do that post hoc. So here's an example of refocusing. Say, after the exposure, I really wanted to focus on her. Or no, maybe I really wanted to focus on him. And you can just, because you have the depth and an all-focus image, you can synthetically defocus her and put him in focus or the person in the back in focus. Okay, moving back. There's really nice work that Ramesh Raskar and collaborators did in a so-called flutter shutter system. Okay, so now, so before the problem we wanted to address was shallow depth of field. Now the problem we're going to address is motion blur. And it's actually a similar story, although in the temporal domain. So if you have a moving toy and you hold the shutter open this length of time, where time's going horizontally, you get a blurred image. And it really, it's the same story, only caused by motion blur now. It has a couple of problems. It's hard to estimate what the blur was. And also, it's hard to deconvolve it because there are a lot of zeros in the Fourier transform of this signal. And so you can see that in the log magnitude plot of the Fourier transform of the sinc function. Instead, you have this very clever idea. Let's open and close very quickly in a pseudo-random pattern the aperture during the exposure. So you hold it open, open, close, and then stop. And so your aperture function as a function of time looks something more like this. And it turns out you can design this pattern so that it doesn't have zeros in the Fourier transform, so that you don't lose as many, or lose any, really, frequencies during this long exposure. And so now, here's the input image with this crazy flutter shutter, and you can see some of the sort of staccato sharp edges that pass through this exposure method. In their work, they had to assume they knew what the direction and speed of the car was, so they've rotated it to take that into account, and then they assume they know the speed of the car, and they can pretty well, much better than with a conventional exposure, they can deblur the result. Okay, different part of the camera. Let's modulate the light source while we take our picture. And this leads us to what I gotta say is my favorite, one of my favorite pieces of work in the past 5 or 10 years, really. It wasn't mine. It's one of where you see it, think, oh, I wish I had thought of that. And this is the fast separation of direct and global images by Sri Nair and collaborators. Here's the idea. When you take a picture, the light at the camera is influenced by the surface in a number of different ways. So there's one piece of what goes into the light in the camera is light goes directly from the source, bounces off the surface, and back to the camera. And that's kind of what we have in our heads for the kind of conventional imaging conditions. But of course, in reality, there are lots of other ways that light gets to the camera. You can have light go here on this surface, then bounce in here, this surface, and then bounce to you, so interreflections. You can have light hit next to that point, rattle around inside the surface, and then pop back out. These are subsurface scattering, and you can see that with some type of rocks and baby skin. You might have light bounce around inside a participating medium, then hit the surface, then bounce back to you. So this would be seeing things through a murky water. And you can even have light hit a translucent surface, then hit the object, and then bounce back to you. Now, let's put all these imaging effects into two different groups. So the first is just the direct one, and all these others we're going to group together and call them global illumination. What do they have in common? Well, what they really have in common is they have a very low spatial frequency response. In other words, the image that you get from this global imaging methods is very, very blurred relative to the image you get from the direct illumination, which is to say, if you light something up, here's what I want to show. No, sorry, didn't get it. If you change this patch here and move it a little bit to the left, it's going to have a very minuscule change on the global illumination component of what the camera sees. Whereas if you move anything here, it'll have a very high frequency effect on what you see. And so the light that you see at the camera is a sum of this direct illumination, the light directly from the source back to the camera, plus this global effect. And in other words, for the global effect as an example, you might have a transfer matrix that relates how much this patch is lit up versus what you see in the camera. And if you move this patch around a little bit, it's really not going to change the light that comes to the camera from seeing the secondary reflection there. So how do we take advantage of that? Let's light up the scene with two different exposures, both very high frequency. So the first is this one. Now, what does the camera see when you light it up that way? Well, you've got the direct illumination component there, and then you've got the global, but it's kind of attenuated somehow. But because it's got such a low frequency response, you can say it's simply what you would get if this were lit up everywhere, but attenuated by the duty cycle of this on-off pattern. So if this is every other patch here, it's just the global component divided by two. Then you might guess what's coming next. Let's change the pattern to invert it. So now this patch here, which was in direct illumination, now is not in direct illumination. But you still have that global pattern. And because it's so low frequency, you really can't tell the difference between the global pattern with one phase and the global pattern with another phase of this on-off square wave pattern. So now you can just add and subtract these two equations and pull out the direct illumination component and the global illumination component. So if the duty cycle is 1/2, then just subtracting one condition from the other gives you the direct component, and just adding together the two gives you the global component. So now you can take a picture like this, and with this simple manipulation, you can separate it out into the image that was formed by light directly striking the surface and directly bouncing back to you, and everything else. And what's so cool is you just see a wonderful new world there of the world illuminated by indirect illumination. So let's take a look at how that works. So here's the on-off pattern that they applied, and here's our first separation. Again, this is not anything I did. This was by Sri Nair and his collaborators. So here's the direct illumination, which looks like kind of an old computer graphics model where you don't have any of the other effects modeled. It's just light directly on the surface bouncing back to you. And then here's this wonderful warm feeling global illumination component There you can see an interreflection at the corner. There you can see, you know, dramatically the translucency and the murky water effects. And they publish this wonderful paper where they give example after example of what the world looks like through this kind of global direct illumination split. So here's one. What do you think it's going to separate this into? Well, here's the direct illumination component. Light just goes between all those particles directly and bounces back. Some particles do that. Some photons do that. And then here's the global illumination component where it rattles around and then bounces back to your eye. Here's peppers. Now, what do you think it's going to do with peppers? What makes the color in a pepper? Well, it's the inside of a pepper that makes the color in a pepper. So the direct illumination component, everything's this almost the same color, no matter what kind of a pepper it is. And then the rich colors are formed by this indirect illumination where the light penetrates the surface, rattles around inside in the subsurface scattering, and then bounces back to your eye. And skin, of course, is a rich source of subsurface scattering. And here's the split of skin into global and direct components. So again, it's not my work, but I love it. I wish it had been my work. it's just such a great idea. Okay. And there's a lot you can do with modifying light in conjunction with sensing, in conjunction with post-processing. So here's a second one, which I also like. As a photographer, I hate flash. I can't stand it. It makes everything look terrible. But of course, you need it many times. And so often we're confronted with this kind of a choice between having something, a flash photograph of something, which loses the whole warmth of a scene, and a non-flash, which might have a lot of extra blur in it, might have extra noise in it, and really doesn't capture the details that you want to capture. And so in this work by my colleague Freda Durand, and simultaneously by researchers at University of Washington and Microsoft, they used two photographs, a flash and a non-flash, and then relatively sophisticated computer graphics methods to blend the two in an artifact-free way to generate the best of both worlds here, where you have the warmth and the tone scale of the non-flash picture, but the details preserved from the flash photograph. Okay, moving back, let's go back to the sensor now. What can you do? How can we expand the design space by making manipulations in the sensor plane at the same time as we take a picture combined with post-processing? Well, so this is some work from my lab, and also in collaboration with Freda Durand and a fantastic postdoc, now researcher at the Weizmann Institute, Anat Levin. So now we're back to the blur issue again. So here's the scene. You want to take a picture. You have things moving around. You don't know how fast they're moving. You want to get everything sharp, no matter how fast it's moving. Okay, so to describe this, let's look at a space-time diagram. And I hope you all remember these from your physics classes as undergrads, but let me just go through it. This bottom axis is space. This axis is time. And let's say we have three things in this little toy two-dimensional world. This orange thing's moving to the left, this is stationary, and this blue thing's moving to the right, a little slower. And now I hope that it makes sense to you that the space-time diagram of that situation is shown here. The green thing doesn't move, so it's got the same position over time, so it just moves up vertically. The orange thing is moving to the left pretty fast, so it's got a steep slope, and it moves like that. And the blue thing's moving slower to the right, so it looks like that. Are we all together on that? I'll take that as a yes. Okay, great, thanks. So, suppose we have a stationary camera with pixels that aren't moving. What are they going to record? Well, here that we've drawn them in here, there are these black things. And they're not moving, that means they go vertically up here. So we know that the green thing's going to be in focus, and these two are going to be blurred, this one a little bit more. A kind of straightforward way to show this is to make a picture of what this thing looks like in the frame of reference of each of the moving objects. So we're going to hop onto the green thing and show what it looks like. Well, it doesn't change, it's just vertical. Hop onto the orange thing, and then this thing will then shear and look like that. And then hop onto the blue thing, that will shear and look like that. And the way you describe the impulse response is to project this down vertically. Then once we've put it in the frame of reference of the moving thing, we just collapse over time. And this is the impulse response of each one of those pixels when they're looking at those three different things. So the green thing has an impulse response because it's not moving relative to the stationary green thing. The blue stuff has an impulse response that looks like this. And the orange stuff, which is moving faster, has an impulse response, which is this thing collapsed vertically, which looks like that. Does that all make sense? Okay, now this is the situation we don't want. We've got these three different things. Each one of them has a different impulse response. So if you see a picture that's blurred in this way, you first have to estimate, okay, is this a blurred thing or is it something that just happens to look like that? And you have to sort that out. And then you have to deconvolve from these things. So again, you've got the same problem. These are hard to deconvolve. Plus, you have to estimate what it is. So here's the quiz. Is there a way you can move the pixels during the exposure? Is there a space-time path you can take such that after you shear that shape to make it be what it would look like in the frame of reference of each of the possible moving things, you get the same shape? If you had some pixel curve, which when you sheared it as you jumped on the different moving things, if it looked the same, then when you projected back down to get the impulse response, it would be the same impulse response. So for all you mathematicians in the audience, is there a curve where you can shear it some unknown amount and you'll get the same curve? And the answer is yes, a parabola. So here's your parabola, and you shear it, which means you replace x in this case by x minus st, where s is the slope of your shearing. You get this curve, and then you can complete the square, and it's got a different space and time origin. It shifts a little bit, but the shape of the curve, that quadratic curve, stays the same whether you shear it or whether you don't. So now, instead of having, this is stationary pixels, now we're going to move our pixels with parabolic acceleration. So we're going to open our shutter, move it slow like that. So in space-time, it makes a parabola. Then when we shear it by jumping on the different moving things and project down, we're going to get the same curve no matter how fast the thing was moving. And so then we can go computationally post-process and deconvolve for that now known impulse response. No matter how fast the thing was moving, it's going to have the same impulse response, and we'll get a sharp image. That's cool. And by the way, it's mathematically very similar to the same manipulations that happen with wavefront coding, but in the time domain rather than space. So that's the story. Somebody says, gee, I'm having a problem with these moving objects with the camera on the tripod. You say, oh, I'll fix that. You rip the camera off the tripod, you move it like this, and you move it like that during the exposure, and you say, there, your problems are solved, but with some post-processing. So let me just show you an example that I hope make it more intuitive. Let's say we have these five dots. We've got these moving as the arrows show. So this one's stationary, moving a little bit, moving a lot. And that's the second frame. If you take a picture of that with stationary pixels, you get this image, and again, it's just showing you kind of visually the different impulse responses you get depending on how fast the dot is moving. If you take the picture of those same things with a parabolic acceleration at the same time, you get this picture. And it's the same impulse response all three times. There's one caveat, I should say. There's an end effect that does vary with the speed of the thing. So this guy cuts off sooner than this one does, but the bulk of the intensity, the meat of the thing, is the same. And in practice, we don't find artifacts due to these differences. So we actually made a little prototype that does that. We put a camera and made this little catenary curve that pushes the thing into parabolic acceleration during the exposure. We had another second camera, identical, off to the right, not shown, to get the stationary exposure. And so here's an example of that. Here's the input from the stationary camera. The background's more or less sharp, and this person who's moving is blurred. Here's the input from our parabolic acceleration camera, everything's blurred, but with that special caveat that they're all blurred in the same way. And then an additional thing I didn't have time to go through, it turns out that this blur is rather benign. It's got a nice impulse in it. It's relatively easy to deblur on top of everything else. And so here's the deblurred version, where we just took a globally spatially invariant inverse filter and applied it. We didn't have to segment out that this thing was moving, this isn't. We just filter the same way everywhere, and we get this image where everything's sharp no matter how fast it's moving. I should say also another caveat. The story only holds in 1D. It's a little more complicated in 2D, but there are many cases where you have predominantly 1D motion. Okay, moving back. Now we're also at the sensor. There's a lot of recent work on putting a lens array in front of the detector to capture a 4D light field. Now again, we're moving off. This is not work I was involved with. This has a long history, but the primary ones to hit are Edward Adelson and John Wang, who proposed this planoptic camera, so-called, and then Mark Lavoie and Ren Ng, who recently revived it and have actually started a company based on this. So if you put a microlens array in front of your sensor, you can, at the trade-off, losing some spatial resolution, you can rig it up so that you can record what part of the lens each ray went through as you record it. So this lets you record not only what's going on here, but what's going on, what was this ray, what was this ray, what was that ray, and record them all separately. I won't go through how, but this is the sort of exposure that you get. So this is obviously a photograph with very high depth variation. And let's zoom in on it and look at these little sub-pixels. So each one of these is at a certain location. What's coded in each of these little circles is of all the light that emanated from this spatial location in the scene, which ray, we now have them separated out according to what part of the lens they came through to arrive at the sensor. And this lets you this gives you now, it's a four-dimensional image rather than a 2D image. A conventional image, of course, is one dimension or another. It's a 2D object. Now we have this 2D thing, but with at every 2D location, we have an inner loop, a two-dimensional thing, saying what part of the lens did this come from? So now we have this 4D structure, which lets us capture the so-called light field, which is the intensity of every ray going in every direction. And it's a 4D thing because we have 2D position, and for every position we have a two-dimensional array of possible directions that the ray could be going. So what can you do if you have this powerful thing, this light field? Well, you can do what a lens does, which is to gather different components of the light field and focus them in a certain way. So you can, you know, again, as with some of the other things I've showed, you can refocus after the exposure by just manipulating this four-dimensional beast into the desired two-dimensional image. So here's some examples of that. And again, this is the refocusing task, but done with entirely different technology, done by recording the 4D light field and then reassembling the light field to make the desired image. So here's an image where this is in focus, where this is in focus, where this is in focus, where this is in focus. And as I mentioned, there's a startup company that sells cameras that do this now. Okay. Sorry with the time. So we have two more things I want to cover. Now, technically, this is not really part of a computational photography, but it's so essential to many of the techniques in computational photography, I want to mention it, and that is a statistical model for images themselves. So you don't really need a camera to have a statistical model for images, but it sure is useful to have that model when you want to go and explore this design space. And this is also one of my favorite topics, and that's deblurring. So here's an image. You've never seen it before. One of them happens to be my son, but that doesn't matter. Can you tell me, is it sharp or is it blurred? Just make a guess. Sharp, thank you, excellent. Okay, this one, What do you think? Yes, great. Now, you've never seen these before. How do you know one is sharp and one is blurred? Well, there are a couple ways you might know. One is you might have a sort of high-level model in your head. You've sort of recognized that, okay, these are supposed to be people. I've got this high-level model of what a person is. I know a person has sharp edges. Those edges aren't sharp, therefore it must be a blurry image. That's one way you do it. And it might, who knows, it might well be what we do. But it's not what you want to have a computer do, because that means you have to solve the high-level vision problem for every image you want to de-blur, and we don't want to have to do that. You'd rather have a low-level, sort of signal processing-level model for what it means to be a blurry image or a sharp image, that you need a statistical model for what's a sharp image. Anyway, we've developed a method, and other people have explored similar things to do that. And the model we're going to use is just to look at the gradients in the image. So in other words, look at the value of one pixel relative to the value of its neighbor. Here's an image. If you plot the magnitude of the gradient for this image on a log vertical scale, so it's a histogram of how often each gradient value occurred. Here's zero, which says that mostly in an image, nothing's going on. Mostly the neighbor is the same value as the one next to it. Kind of a boring image, but every once in a while, things happen and you get these non-zero image gradient values. I should add that you can tell right away that images, that Gaussian noise is not a good model for images, because if it were a good model, what would this look like? This would, on this log vertical scale, this would be an inverted parabola if this were Gaussian noise. And it's not, so it's something different. If we make a blurred image, we have quite a different shape. And this is part of the core of how we developed our non-blind, our blind deconvolution method. So about 6 years ago, the super postdoc I was working with developed a method which we felt, or we believe, was the first method to reliably do blind deconvolution on sort of conventional photographs that people would send us and we could do it. And since then, this has generated a lot of interest in the computer graphics and computer vision communities for this task. So here's the problem, the setup. You have a blurry image, and you want to explain it as some sharp image that you want to estimate, plus some unknown blur kernel that you also want to estimate. For the sake of this work, we're going to assume that everything is blurred the same way throughout the image. So we're not going to allow the differently moving objects for this work. And also, we're not going to allow people to move the camera like this when they take the picture, because that also gives a non-uniform blur kernel over the image. Okay, here's why I like this problem so much. It's delightfully underdetermined. So here's the blurry image. Here's an explanation for it. This is the one we happen to want. Some sharp latent image, some blur kernel made it. But here's another perfectly good explanation for it. That's just what the thing looked like. You took a sharp picture of something that looked like that. Now, it's actually a better explanation mathematically than this one, because this one accounts for the noise, everything perfectly. It's just, you know, what a strong likelihood function this one has. Whereas this one, it's not going to be exactly, it's going to be noise and stuff. How can you say that you want this explanation over this explanation? And I, in case anyone's wondering, this picture of the blur kernel is the image you would get if you were photographing a point of light and you move the camera in the same way that you're talking about the motion during the exposure. So that's a picture of the blur kernel. That's how one point gets blurred, and so you convolve it over the whole image. And if you're sort of pathologically minded, you can also come up with other image blur kernels that explain the same data. So it's the image prior that's going to save us from favoring this explanation over this one. In our sort of Bayesian reconstruction approach, we have these three terms. We have the reconstruction that whatever you choose for your latent image and whatever you choose for your blur kernel, it better equal the data that you saw or something close to it. And then we have priors over what we think images look like, based on the distribution of their gradients. And we also have a kind of weak priors over what we think, how we think people blur the image, that it's a sort of sparse matrix that is the Spiller kernel. And you can put it all together. There's some details about how you do the Bayesian inference. It turns out that the MAP approach is actually not what you want to do in this case. You'd rather do something that involves integrating over many different possible candidate images. So that means variational approach or a different loss function. But those are details that are described in papers available on our webpage. And the result is a reasonably good deep learning method. So here's an original image taken inside a museum. You're not allowed to use flash. And here's the estimated blur kernel and the deconvolved image. Nothing against MATLAB, but just to say there's a hard problem, if you take MATLAB's decon blind and apply it, you don't get a good result. And here's close-ups of that, the original, the brand X, if you will, blind deconvolution, and then our method, which makes things better revealed. So here's a telephoto shot of a bird, and there's a little bit of camera motion there in the exposure. You can't make out the bird's legs, but if you do this blind deconvolution method, you can estimate that this is how the camera moved during the exposure, and this is the picture that you wanted to see. There are still some residual artifacts. I should mention the sort of the field has a little bit gone beyond this work by really addressing the engineering details, and people are publishing papers now without these ringing artifacts. And again, the original, just to show you can't do simple sharpening, and instead you need to estimate the blur kernel and deconvolve properly. Okay, and post-capture processing, right. This is also something that I just find delightful, sorry. We want to make a microscope for motion. So this is the swing set behind my house. That's my wife on the swing. We track points, being careful to avoid occlusion artifacts. We group the tracked points. The beam moves just a tiny bit in response to her swinging. And then we interpolate between the track's feature points to get a layered motion representation of the video. Now, the user says, take the red stuff and amplify its motion by a factor of 40. So now we're going to put everything back together. We push those pixels, but now we're pushing them beyond where we saw data, so we're going to use texture synthesis methods to fill in the missing details. And now we have a motion microscope where we can see the small motions. And my wife asked me humorously if she thinks the video makes her look heavy. And I say, no. other examples, here's the motions that someone exerts when they're trying to balance upside down. Again, exaggerated so you can see what's going on. If you push down on this aluminum support, the thing moves a little bit. We can detect that and exaggerate it. Often, parents of perfectly healthy newborn babies ask, is the baby breathing? And so now we can find out. you can also do science with this. So this is from a colleague at MIT. They're interested in the deformation of this membrane in the ear as acoustic waves propagate across it. In the unmagnified sequence, you really can't see the form of the deformation. But in the magnified version, you can see how the membrane deforms in response to the acoustic wave. And this is all magnifying motions relative to zero motion. You can also magnify one motion relative to another. So here's a car going over a bump. The top one had nothing in the trunk. The bottom one had some mass in the trunk. We'd like to be able to distinguish that visually. So we track the two cars. We use dynamic time warping to put them in register temporally. Then we amplified the differences between the two motions and re-rendered them on top of the cars to give this sequence. So now we can see that it's the bottom car that is bouncing in response to the extra weight, extra mass in the trunk. And we think there's a lot more that you can do with this type of approach. So that's the story. Again, it's a few of my favorite things. It's not comprehensive. It's also, I should stress again, not all my work. I tried to distinguish what was, what wasn't. And it's, as you all know, really, it's an exciting new design space. There's a lot of things to do. And I think we're all having fun exploring this. In the interest of cross-fertilization, here are some other conferences which also explore this. SIGGRAPH, the graphics conference, CBCR, the main vision conference. This is a new one called the International Conference on Computational Photography, which I have to say is in the kind of the glory era of its new little self. It's really, a lot of people from different disciplines go to this one now, and it's an exciting little workshop. Typically, it happens in the spring. Anyway, that's the story. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Bill, for such an enlightening and educational plenary. I think we have time for a couple of questions. We are on a tight schedule, but are there any questions? Or
raise your hand.
Okay, so let's thank our speaker one more time. Thank you, Bill.